glad to be here this evening. Thank you for being with us here at First Baptist Church for this this Christmas Eve candle lighting service. And I am here for the traditional Christmas story. We're going to sing together, we're going to rejoice together, we're going to celebrate the coming of the Lord Jesus and what that means in our lives. So we're grateful that you're here spending this time with us this evening. Now you'll notice in your bulletin that we're going to do something that we don't normally do on Christmas Eve, and that is we're going to pass the offering plate, okay? And that's because for some people, this is going to be the last service of the year, and it's the last Sunday, so we'll go ahead and do that for our members. If you are a guest tonight who wants to give twice as much, because we might not see you again for a while, and so please don't worry about that. We'll give you my okay. We're glad that you're here. Don't feel any pressure when the plate is passed. Just let God lead you in how you want to give. And we're going to do that. For those people, they're going to stay in with their families in the morning. But now, we also are going to have a 10:45 worship service. We're going to stay here in the morning. And we'd love for you to come back and return for that. And then bring some friends along with you. So we're glad that you're here. I've met a lot of people from different places. Some from way out of town that are here with family, and some from the neighboring communities. So we're grateful that you're here with us. You received a bulletin that you came in, and if you would like to, you can give us some information about yourself. If you'd like us to follow up with you in some way, if you need a church home, if you have a matter that you'd like us to be praying about, we would be glad to do that for you. All right? I think that it would be great. I'm going to lead us in a prayer in just a moment. But would you just stand together and then greet each other with a word of peace in the Lord? And then I'll lead us in a prayer. Just welcome back. Tell somebody you love you.
Okay, love you.
Out of you will come for me, one who will be ruler over Israel.
Would you stand together as we sing "A Little Town of Bethlehem"?
Scripture reading is from Matthew 1, 18 through 21. This is how the birth of Jesus Christ came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph. But before they came together, she was found to be with child through the Holy Spirit. Even though Joseph, her husband, was a righteous man and did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he hadn't wanted to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered it, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name of Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins."
Yeah. reading from Luke, chapter 2, verses 25 through 33. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon, who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Spirit was upon him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord Christ. Moved by the Spirit, he went into the temple courts, and the parents brought in the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the law required. Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, "Sovereign Lord, as you have promised, you now dismiss your servant in peace. For my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all people, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and for glory to your people, Israel." The child's father and mother marveled at what was said about him.
This season, the joy brought through Jesus Christ. We sing joy to the world. Would you stand again as we sing?
They opened their treasures.
bless this offering to the betterment of your kingdom, Lord, and bless the gift and the giver, Lord. These things we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Came seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. This is John's way of saying he was born, came into our midst. So what do we do with this Emmanuel, God with us, God in our making his dwelling with us? What do we do with that? Well, we're told of John the Baptist. It says John the Baptist was not the light, but he was a witness of the light. And that's what we're to do. We are to bear witness to the light that he came. We bear witness of his coming. And we're told why he came and what we're bearing witness to. In him was life. Now listen. Life is life in the Spirit. It is life that raises the dead. It is eternal life. It is the gift of God's salvation that makes us alive. In him was life. Life in the Spirit. And that life was the light of all man, all mankind. And the light shines in the darkness, and the darkness cannot withstand it, cannot hold it back. And we, like John, are to bear witness to this light and this light that has come. People matter to God. You know, as a pastor, I have opportunity to be placed in situation, circumstance after circumstance, where I have firsthand experience, where I say God moved in a mighty way. He said the only way that God could do that, the only way that could happen was an act of God. God alone had to do that. You know what I'm talking about? Amen? It was God. And often I'm invited in those kind of circumstances. So I remember several years ago, when I was pastoring in a small town, West Texas town, about 1,600 people, it was the week of Christmas, and the lady in the church called me and said, "Pastor, come across a young woman in our community that just found out that she has 5 children, that they have nothing for Christmas, they don't have any money, they don't have any presents, they don't have any food. Can our church help?" Absolutely. So why don't you get the names of the lady and get the names of the kids and sizes and wishes and that kind of thing. And we're starting to put together some money and some gifts and food for them. It's going to be great. So she reported back to me. The mother's name was Monica. Monica was in her early 20s. She had 5 children. They were all stair-step. 5, 4, 3, 2, and an infant. And then we found out that, you know, we had a couple of boys and some girls, and then they had 3 different last names. There was a man in the household who think that he was the father to the little infant. So what it tells us is that there's some stuff there in her life. There's some brokenness and concerns that were there in her life. So all of that came with that information. And we began to gather things together, gather together some money, gather together the food, and gather together the gifts. And it was Christmas Eve. And the lady called me and said, "Pastor, we have everything together. It's here at the church. But we'd like for you to live with. Would you do that?" See how pastors get placed in such situations and circumstances. We get to see the move of God. And I said, "Absolutely." So I went over to church, I grabbed one of the deacons of the community, and I said, "I want you to go with him and deliver this to this home." He said, "Be glad to help." So we loaded everything in the church van. We drove the 3.5 blocks down the way from the church building to where Monica and the kids lived, and showed up, and she was expecting us. And knocked at the door, we were greeted by these 4 little children at the door. And they're 5, 4, 3, 2, yeah, they're just dead. And they were just there, open the door. And so I said, "Well, we just talk about food." So we started to unload all the food. It was a feast for that family for Christmas Eve and for Christmas Day. It was a feast. We began to unload in a little modest apartment, 2 bedrooms, little kitchenette. We began to unload all that food. And then we started to unload all of the little Christmas gifts. And you know, I had this little planted all the gifts underneath that tree. And the oldest, the five-year-old, was trying to help situation. You know, trying to take over, trying to put everything right. This is mine, this is yours, this is that, trying to help him out. Everything underneath that tree. And then Monica, the mother, was sitting in a cloth covered chair. She was holding a little baby. She didn't say anything. And the kid said, "Can we open the gifts now?" "Yeah, we can come in." And they began to open gifts. There was clothes and toys and all kinds of things underneath every gift. And listen, there is nothing more wonderful than to see the bright-eyed children opening gifts on Christmas. And Mother Monica, the mother, she's sitting over there holding the baby. She didn't say a word throughout the whole time. She said thank you when we got ready to leave. And I looked over into the cloth-covered chair, and there she was holding the baby. I don't know, I thought about it, and I thought this may be the first time in a long time that she had ever felt real love. Real love. And that's what that was. It was real love. She began to share the love of Jesus for her, for her children, for the household. Talk about why Jesus came just very briefly. She held hands and closed with a word of prayer and left. I'd like to say that a couple of weeks later that Monica and the kids came to church. But after the holidays, I went over to visit. They had moved. They were gone. And I thought maybe the money that was given, that may have given them a new lease of life, a new beginning, something good happened. That's what I was thinking. But something else came to mind. And that was this. That one day, was standing before the Lord. And ever how he does that, we have that group of people that were so insistent about helping this little family. And we stand before the Lord, and he says in his home way, "They're all here. They're all here." That's what I would like to think, that somehow the seed of the gospel and the seed of love was sown so deep into their lives that they could not resist the gospel, the good news that was demonstrated to them in that evening. And somehow by God's grace, now many years later, when we stand before the Lord, he says, "They're all here." I would hope and pray that that would be the case. But I can tell you this, that the Christmas story and John's theology speaks to us several truths. One truth about Christmas is that there is a risk involved. There's a risk. Do you know that in John chapter 1, verse 11, it says that he came to his own, and his own did not receive him. Can you read that? They rejected him. So there's some that will never receive the love of Jesus. They will never receive the message, the good news. Here's the second thing, risk. The second thing is that Christmas is about redemption. Verse 12 says, "But to those who received him, those who believed on his name, he made to become children of God." We believe on him and cast ourselves onto him. It's about redemption and relationship. And listen, in verse 16 it says, listen to this, "And if it's true and resonates with you, say amen. And from the fullness of his grace we have all received one blessing after another." Amen. It's about risk. There's a risk involved. When we were reflecting the love of God, there was a risk in his coming. Some would not receive him. There's a risk when we fight to reflect his love for others. There's about redemption and relationship. The other thing is that Christianity teaches us that Christmas is about reward. Not the reward of the things we deserve. Not the reward of the things of stuff that we can receive. But it is the reward of serving others. It is the reward of a servant hearing the master say, "Well done. Well done. You did good." Later, John would write, his first little letter, 1 John chapter 4, verse 12, says, "No one has seen God. We couldn't look directly into the brightness of the sun without burning out our retina. We need a filter for the glory and the greatness of God is found in Jesus Christ. No one has seen God. But if we love one another, God lives in us, and his love is manifested through us to others. Others see God through us. The real reward is lifting up Jesus and hearing the Master say, well done. Well done, a good and faithful servant." Can I just say, just as that invitation, we're going to ask you to come forward. But where we are, that there may be someone here that's very much in need of the saving grace of Jesus Christ in your life. Like Monica, you're wanting to receive, you need to receive that gift of love. You do that by asking him to forgive you of your sins. You repent, turn to him. That's why you can. He came because he loves you, he matters. But for us as believers, for many of us that need a recommissioning of what Christmas is all about the gospel, about his coming into our lives and our lives like the love to others. But listen, all of us tonight can receive a fullness of joy into our lives, be overcome by him, and leave this place with the brightness in our spirit. We're just letting work in our hearts. Hopefully, we'll do that. Well, some of us in here, we don't remember. The light came on in the atmosphere. Did you see that? Anybody see that? It was just like, whoa, man. You know, the reason it's just getting dark outside, when it started getting dark, there was a sensor that caused the light to come on the cross. We come in here to celebrate the coming of Jesus and to look for the return of Jesus, to commit our lives to him and to reflect his death and his life. To light our candle, I'm going to light it with the Christ candle. I'm going to ask the ushers if they would come and they're going to help, and I'm going to light theirs and they're going to help, and then we're going to sing and we're going to go out into our world and we're going to rejoice that Jesus has come.
Oh,
work in such a way to bring glory to our Father in heaven. As we go, we take our life with us, share with family and with friends. Go and set this world on fire in Jesus Christ. God bless you.